साक्षात् परम ब्रह्मा तस्मै श्री गुरवे नमः तस्मै श्री गुरवे नमः तस्मै श्री गुरवे नमः। वी आर इन 18th चैप्टर ऑफ ज्ञानेश्वरी भावार्थ दीपिका मोक्ष संन्यास योग एंड वर्स नंबर 54 ओवी नंबर 1110 द वर्स इज ब्रह्म भूत प्रसन्नात्मा न शोचति न कांक्षति समस्त सर्वेषु भूतेषु मद्भक्तिं लभते पराम। सो वी आर ऑन सो विल रीड फ्रॉम 1111 तैसी मी एक वाचूनी काही तया तया ही सकट नाही हे चौथी भक्ति पाही माझी तोला हे ये रातु जिज्ञासु अर्थार्थी हे भजती जिये पंथी ते तीन ही पावोनी चौथी मणिपत आहे येरवीजी ना चौथी हे पहिली ना सरती मैं पै माझी ये सहज स्थिति भक्ति नाम जे नेणे माझे प्रकाशूनी अन्यथा त्वे माते दाऊनी सर्व ही सर्वी भजौनी बुझावी तसे जे जो जे तैसे पाहो बैसे तया ते तैसे ची असे हे उजियेडे का दिसे अखंडे जेने। He says here, So what he was saying before was that when the subject and object, the knower and the known, the seer and the seen, the experiencer and the experienced, meaning the subject and the object, when they merge together, then there is no differences left. And that is the continuous, that is the climax, that is the acme of your search. Of your search for what? Search for happiness, search for realization. Search, all your desires end. In other words, all your desires are satisfied in one go at one time. All the desires. Because what do you find yourself to be? That you are all that there is. And how do you find that out? You find that out. My neck, you come there. Sorry. And how do you find that out? Without a thought. How can you speak without a thought and you have an experience? Get there and find out. So this is the type of language that is used. It's a contradictory language. And we have to always be mindful that no language, no words, no objective approach can ever give you the experience of that infinite absolute reality, because you are that essentially already. So where is the knower and known? In the mind. Where is the subject object? In the mind. Where is the experiencer experienced? In the mind. Where is the waker and the waking world? In the mind. Where is the dreamer and dream world? In the mind. Where is the absence of both in the mind? And who are you? Who are you? Other than the mind? Other than the mind? And yet pervading the whole thing. Yet pervading, supporting the whole thing. The material out of which the mind is made is nothing but you, the Parabrahma Paramatma.
Are you other than the mind or you are not slave of the mind?
Both. You are not slave of the mind when you are a seeker. You are, and when you say you are not a slave of the mind, then who am I? You are the master of the mind. Means you are, don't look for yourself in the mind. How do you look for something in the mind? By way of thought. By way of thought. But who are you? Thought free existence. You don't have to think that I am, and yet you are. So this is the mind is trying to work it out, but it can never work it out, but it needs to be convinced. And with that conviction, it needs to remain, without knowing it, it needs to remain fixed on the transcendental, the absolute reality, be in pursuit of the subject itself. The subject is in pursuit of itself. And in that process, somewhere the mind dissolves. Just as, very simple, just as you desire an ice cream, you become one with the ice cream, and the desire for the ice cream dissolves from your mind. That desire does not remain anymore. Just like you desire sleep, you work towards the sleep, you become single-pointed towards the sleep, and eventually the waker who wanted to go to sleep becomes one with sleep and loses his identity. Same thing is required on the spiritual pursuit also. So when we are, if we want to recognize who we essentially are, the subject has to dissolve his subjectiveness. Because that subjectiveness is only in opposition to objectiveness. Because he's thinking. Till that thinking, does thinking need to dissolve? Afterwards, it's immaterial. As a seeker, you need to dissolve that and abide in the self as the self, free of thought. Come once to realize that you are all that there is without a thought. Thereafter, whether thoughts come or don't come, phenomena will continue. You cannot do anything about it. So this is the great goal that has been presented to us by the scriptures, and every religion is following that, wants to follow that. They get lost on the way. Every religion. But Vedanta doesn't allow you, Upanishads, they do not allow you to stray away. They keep pulling you back to the essential point, who you are, that you are that. And in this manner, we are in the, when a person, when a person wakes up, the dream vanishes, and only the dreamer remains. Similarly, so dream vanishes, dreamer remains, but dreamer remains as what? See, these are the points to contemplate upon. When you are dreaming, you don't know that you are dreaming. Then you wake up from the dream. And the moment you wake up from the dream, you can't even remember the dream. But here he says, the way Jnaneshwar Maharaj is, or the comment, he's saying, the dreamer remains. Dreamer remains as what? As the waker. Who knows that dream was only a phenomena. It was just a figment of imagination. It was only a projection, nothing to be serious about. And in one go, he drops the whole thing. Now, when the waker wakes up from his waking dream, so the dreamer woke up to be a waker and he dropped the dream world. Now the waker wakes up, what will he drop? What will be dropped? The waking world. And who will he be?
Consciousness.
Yeah, the absolute reality, the pure consciousness, the absolute truth. That is the position. See? And this taking the position, this window to come to this position is available millions and millions of times during the day. When? Between two thoughts. Every day, between every two thoughts, it's available. But we don't know how to slow it down and remain without projecting any thought thereafter. We create entanglements by our own choice. So we have to choose wisely. So here he says, so my devotee does not see anything except myself here. I think I mentioned this point. Lord Sri Krishna is not taking myself as a in person who's standing opposite of Arjuna. Here, when he's saying as myself, he's taking himself to be the supreme person, the infinite reality. Does not see anything except myself. And who is he? He's Parabrahma Paramatma. He's Satchidananda Swarup. He's the all-pervading reality. He thus attains the fourth form of devotion. This is called the fourth kind in order to distinguish it from the devotion of one in distress, of the seeker of knowledge, and of the seeker of riches. So here the words that were used is artu jigyasu artharthi. Artu is the one who is in distress. We remember God, we remember something higher when? You remember doctor when? Not because you love the doctor. When you are in disease, something is paining, then you remember doctor. When doctor is not able to find a solution, then what do you do? Then you call out to the Lord, Bhagwan, mere ko is problem se, remove me from this problem, blah, 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 blah. So first type of devotees are who remember divine, whether with form or without form, they get oriented towards it only when they are in trouble. Second type of people, that the jigyasu is those seeker devotees of God who want to know God, who want to explore, who are curious. What is this God? What does he really look like? Can I be one with him? Can I attain him? Will his grace flow? They say, and jigyasu means curiosity and urge to know. And that is the second type. And the third is this. The artharthi. Artharthi is, artha is wealth. Wealth is either physical wealth or spiritual wealth. And spiritual wealth is nothing but going to all the seven planes of existences, achieving them. They are the different heavens. And with each heaven, you get various powers. And that is the wealth. That wealth was offered to Nachiketa by the Lord of Death. He says, I don't care for that. I don't want. But he still gave it to him. He put the garland around his neck. That garland represents the entire nature, the entire relative. So the first was Artha, the one who is distressed. He is remembering God. Second is Jigyasu, he who is curious, wants to know what is the nature of God. Third is Artharthi, who is after wealth. He thinks of God. If you reflect upon it, there is no such devotion as the third or the fourth or even the first and the last. In fact, that which is my innate state is devotion. So here he says, where are we? So all these different types of devotions, we have categorized them. One who is distressed, one who is curious, one who is wanting wealth. But devotion per se cannot be divided. Because Lord is saying, my nature itself is devotion. So here when he says that there is no such devotion as third or fourth or even the first and the last. In fact, so it is not I began with devotion and I'm going to conclude. And what was the conclusion? No, you begin with devotion, you conclude with devotion. A devotee begins as a devotee and at the end he continues to remain a devotee. But his understanding as a devotee is different at the end. Why? He has merged with the divine. First, he was separate to divine. Now he has merged with the divine and the phenomena continues. The devotion continues. Just like a realized person, before he was a seeker, then he got realized. Because he got realized, will he stop eating food? Will he stop going to sleep? Will he stop walking? No. Where will I walk? I am everywhere. I will not walk. It does not happen. You see the realized masters also walking. So phenomena continues. So, or even the first, in fact, that which is my innate state, that which is my nature, that which is my innate state is that of devotion. See? So don't consider devotion to be the feeling that is emanating in your heart when you are thinking of the divine. You get horripilations. People misunderstand. The tears come, the horripilations come, you see lights, you see traffic lights, you see the rainbow colors, you hear so many musical instruments, you hear so many experiences you go through, and they say, oh, you know, because I am a great devotee, so I am getting all this, it is by the gate's growth. And they take all these different signs to be signs of devotion. No, these are not signs of devotion. Here Bhagwan is being very clear. Those signs of devotion were valid in 12th chapter, 10th chapter, 11th chapter, not in 18th chapter. He's taking you there. There you needed that support. Just like Arjuna needed the support, he needed to experience the total form of the Lord. Before getting to that form, he needed to be inspired to that particular point. It was a natural unfoldment. He says, how do I find you in the creation? He said, among the Himalaya, among the mountains, I am the Himalayas, among the river, I am the Ganga, among the trees, I am the Ashwatha. So he gave a specific point of contact with which he could relate. And then he says in the 10th chapter that you and me can have this conversation and I can keep going. This list is not going to end. Arjuna says, this list is not going to go. Is there a possibility that I can experience all your specificities in one go? So he says, but he was not qualified. Then the 11th chapter began. And he had, but his mind could not handle it. So here we are not talking about that specificity. Then again, an objective experience. Yes, it was a transcendental in the sense the third eye was opened. He was given a divine vision of the total form, where past, present, future, creation, maintenance, destruction, all was happening at the same time. And it was too much for Arjuna's mind to handle. See? So is that devotion? No, he got scared. He got scared of that. He was not, he immediately prayed, please come to your pleasing form. I cannot handle this form. It is scary. Scary in the sense, if you are not prepared in your mind, it becomes scary when you see it objectively. Isn't this creation, maintenance, destruction continuously going on in your in you? Cells are born, cells are maintained, cells are dying. Breath is in breath is created, is maintained, is it ends. Thoughts are created, thoughts are maintained, thoughts also die. See, but there it doesn't get very, you don't get afraid of that. But when you are looking at it objectively, then it becomes, because this separation, this distance, how will devotion increase then? If you are afraid, how will devotion increase? So he asks, please come into your pleasing form. So he comes back into, but there the form was still there. Now we are in moksha sannyasa yoga, where we are coming to ananya bhakti, exclusive devotion. And that exclusive devotion, he has to discover that devotion. He is thinking of the divine. But what if, has he realized that that divine is his nature? If the divine is his nature, where is the devotion? What is the nature of devotion? Of the nature of the self. Now, whom will he be devoted to? See what happens. This point came yesterday also. When we chant Om, or when we chant Om Namah Shivaya, Om Namo Narayanaya, initially the seeker becomes single-pointed, focused, and wants to search the essence of the divine with whom he is interacting. This is what he is, even if it is the Atman, even if it is the self, he is single-pointedly, who am I, and he is available to it. In that silence or in that mantra, whatever. And he loses all objectivity. The only object of focus is the divine thought, the thought which is indicating the divine. And as he prepares all creates the mindset to surrender to that goal of that, to that divine which he has chosen to be surrendered to, the moment he surrenders in that seeking, the goal, the I, the Shiva, the Narayana, the Krishna, the Rama, they come and pervade your mind and heart. So first you were seeking, and once you are ready to lose yourself, completely dissolved, the divine, it comes and pervades you completely. Now, pervades you completely means what? You do not have an individual identity left. Every thought gets divinized, every breath gets divinized. I'm saying this way. From that point, nothing, it's only divine and divine everywhere. So initially you are leaving the whole world and becoming focused, just as in sleep. Sleep is not far away. You focus on the sleep, you surrender to the sleep, and what does sleep do? It pervades your heart, it pervades your body, it pervades your mind. You're completely engulfed in it. You have got no identity there. Imagine if that is exactly what is happening in deep sleep, you are ignorant. Imagine, same thing happens, but you are conscious. वो कितना मजेदार सोच के मजा आ जाता है. That you are wakeful. You are aware. You are alert. Alert about what? About nothing and everything. About nothing and everything. How will that? A thought-free, I alone am. There's nothing else other than me. This is the acme of seeking. This is what this chapter is leading you to. Brahma Bhuta Prasannatma. Such a person never gets bogged down, ever blissful, ever smile. Krishna Bhagwan, from childhood till the end, he has that divine smile on his face. Not one day, they did not allow him one day to sit quietly. Continuous, from the before birth, all problems began. Every day problems coming. Every week, every month. And the intensity of the problems are only becoming bigger and bigger and bigger. But he doesn't lose who he is. He knows. He is the infinite reality. When he wants, for Arjuna's sake, for Bhishmacharya's sake and Dronacharya's sake, he took the form of the Virat, of the total manifestation. He took, but when he is giving instructions to Arjuna, he is taking the role of an individual. But whether he takes the role of the individual, a phenomenal existence, whether he takes the role of a total phenomenal existence, he never forgets that he is the infinite one. And when you are the infinite, depending upon the phenomenal circumstances, whatever is required will appear. He doesn't even have to do anything. It's mirror doesn't have to do anything. If I go there, Samidha will not reflect from the mirror. I will only reflect. So it depends what type of Arjuna asked. Krishna reflected and gave him that vision. So I know they are all statements with no concrete ending. This is how we work in this world. This is a cup. This is a book. This is a laptop. It's a conclusion. But when we are speaking about this, the infinite, the total, the infinite absolute reality and the phenomenal, how can you be both at the same time? You have to get there. How can gold be infinite and yet be an ornament? How can water be infinite and yet be the total ocean and the individual wave? Contemplate on this, not as water. Apply it on yourself. These are worthy contemplations. If you contemplate like this, you will vanish. Personality will dissolve. Doesn't take too long. These are the meditations, pointers. But a devotee is misled by ignorance in that he conceives me in a form different from my essential nature and worships it. So a devotee means the savikalpa, the one who is thinking of the God, the divine, as a form, because he wants to see because a devotee considers himself to be a form, considers himself to be limited by space-time objectivity. So he creates a divine idea also, which is determined by total space, total time, and total objectivity. And what does he give it a name? God. Understand the principle. And then in his own imaginations, at the relative level, from absolute standpoint, we can only talk of it as imagination. At relative level, forget the absolute. We can't forget it, but it's there. But it's formless, attributeless. So at relative level, we do not deny the Ishvara. Because if you have accepted the relative, means you have accepted you are an individual. And when you accept yourself as an individual, you are the effect. And for this creation, there must be a cause. And that cause is Ishvara. And that is the phenomena at the totality level, which is going on. So that is for the seeker. That is for the one who has not realized yet. But from absolute point, is there anything? No, only absolute is. So does the phenomena stop? For whom? For the absolute, there is no phenomena. Who is asking the question? Is the absolute asking the question? Does the phenomena stop? No. You and me are asking the questions. We are still in the relative. So when you are asking the question in the relative, scriptures are talking in the relative, Ishvara is. Transcendental reality is. Ishvara is the first phenomena, Ishvara and Prakriti, or Ishvara Maya, or Shiva Shakti, first phenomena, and then the resultant. See? So here he is saying that a devotee is misled by ignorance because of incomplete knowledge. So many people, even after studying, see Ramanujacharya or Madhavacharya, Madhavacharya, he considered, you cannot become one with God. The world is God, you can only serve. And he wrote commentary on Upanishads based on that point. Ramanujacharya, his belief was, we are a spark of God. Because of ignorance, we have separated, and then we can merge back. Based on that philosophy, which is called Vishishta Advait, first was Dvaita philosophy, this is Vishishta Advait philosophy. He wrote commentaries on Upanishad based on that. Then you take our Paramahansa Yogananda, he wrote commentary on Bhagavad Gita based on Raja Yoga. See? And then there is the commentary of Vedanta, which puts into correct context all these standpoints which various masters have taken. See, that's the beauty of Adi Shankaracharya. So if we are looking at Upanishad, Prabhupada, he looks at his commentary something else only. See, Krishna consciousness, Krishna, ask any question, no answer. No, just chant Krishna. Yes, it can. But if your mindset is that Krishna consciousness is not is the infinite consciousness and it is a particular form, then that's where you are going to get to. You can't go beyond form. You can't go beyond attributes. Because that's the way of your approach. And here he says that approach is misled by ignorance. Because of incomplete knowledge, we are going in that direction. Now, if you heard yesterday's Kathopanishad, there what is it said? Instead of choosing any god, you chant Om. Om is the source of all the words, all the mantras. And there it is saying that if your attention while chanting Om is on some god, you will get to that god. But if while chanting Om, your attention is on the transcendental reality, the Om will deliver you that because it is that. It is that. So now we are studying Amrit. I'm just thinking loudly here. So we are doing Amrit Anubhav. In Amrit Anubhav, how did the first chapter begin? That there is Paramashiva. Paramashiva, absolute reality. He has got no form. He has got no qualities. He has got no attributes. He wanted to now at relative level to explain how the creation comes about. He says, He desired to experience himself. So the first phenomenal experience was Shiva Shakti. You understand? So now, if we chant Om Namah Shivaya with our attention on the Paramashiva, it will take you there. But what is Paramashiva? Formless, attributeless reality. If you chant Narayana and understand that Narayana is not just the person who is the form which is sleeping on the Adishesha, on the Milky Ocean with the his Shakti, that is Lakshmi there. If you don't get caught up in the form, use that form to transcend the form. Then it is, that is what we call Dharana, Dhyan, Samadhi. So what is Samadhi? Samadhi is again two types, Savikalpa and Nirvikalpa. Savikalpa is, first Samadhi is with form, then the higher Samadhi is with sound, and the third, highest Samadhi is without form and without sound. Now, where is our attention? Majority of the people here, Jnaneshwar Maharaj is saying, because in front of him, pandits are also there, great learned scholars are there, farmers are there, the entire cross-section of the society is sitting in front of him. He has to cater to everyone and inspire them to be devoted to to move towards perfection, to move towards the infinite. So here he says, but a devotee is misled by ignorance in that he conceives me. Who is Krishna? The Parabrahma Paramatma. That formless, attributeless reality is conceived in a form different from my essential nature. So what is his essential nature? Formless. And what are you conceiving him as? As some form with some attributes and all paraphernalia. He is carrying the Trishul, or he is carrying the Sudarshan, Shankha, Chakra, Gada, Padma. Oh, but you only gave that form in the 12th chapter. You don't go in the past. Reality is only in the present moment, here and now. don't digress. That was a link which was necessary at that time. From 13th chapter onwards, the Gnyan Mark, the path of knowledge, has begun. From first chapter was the yoga of crisis, identity crisis. From second chapter till 6th chapter or 5th chapter, it is the Karma Yoga. From 6th chapter is Dhyana Yoga. 7th chapter to 12th chapter is Bhakti Yoga. From 13th chapter to 17th chapter is Jnana Yoga. 18th chapter is Moksha Sannyas. You are going beyond everything. You are going to Moksha Sannyas, meaning you are going to give up the desire for liberation also. Understand the scheme. If I continue to have the desire to know my essential self, I'll remain in relativity. If I continue to have the desire to go to sleep, I will not go to sleep. Somewhere I have to let it go. Somewhere I have to surrender that desire, isn't it? At some altar. There, at the altar of sleep, you surrender it. So my desire for liberation, if I am desiring liberation through Ram, then I surrender it at Ram, but I have got an idea of Ram that he is in Saket, that he is with Ram, Sita, Lakshman and Hanumanji, then I will go to that abode. I will not go to the infinite reality. What are we focusing our mind upon? Choose wisely. Mantra is not a problem. Any mantra you can, but what is it? What is your angle of approach to it? But a devotee is misled by ignorance in that he conceives me in a form different from my essential nature and worships it. The devotee who conceives me thus maintains his faith in that form. And that is okay. For many people, it is okay. Some people like who have an itch like us, we are not satisfied with that. We want to know this also. And we want to know the transcendental also. Is it possible? Yes. Om, if you go to Om, Om gives you both the relative as well as the transcendental. Who is Ishvara? Who is Ishvara? Ishvara is he who is not disturbed by his own potentiality, but at the same time knows his absolute reality. Got it? This is Ishvara Advaita. The way Jnaneshwara's approach is this. There is no demarcation line. This or that. No. Everything is complete. Ever. Continuing in the 116th verse, the OV. Tevha atmatve shochave kahi pavavaya kamave he sarale samabhave bharite taya उदयायेता गभस्ति नाना नक्षत्र व्यक्ति हारवीजति दीप्ति आंगिका जेवी देवी उठतिया आत्मप्रथा हे भूत भेद व्यवस्था मोडीत मोडीत पार्था वासपा हेतो पाटिये वरील अक्षरे जैसी पुसता येति करे तैसी हारपति भेदांतरे तयाचिये दृष्टि तैसेनी अन्यथा ज्ञाने जिये घेपति जागर स्वप्ने तिये दोन्ही के लीलीने अव्यक्ता माझी. He says, just as the appearance or non-appearance of a dream depends on the existence of one dreamer, so the natural light by which one sees the existence or non-existence of the universe is what is known as devotion. Now see, Jnaneshwara Maharaj is taking you to a different level. He is not talking about devotion in your mind. He is saying your nature, the itself is of the true nature. Your essence is devotion itself. Because it is of nature. What is devotion? Love. You are of the nature of love. You don't have to seek love. You don't want to become love. You don't want to receive love. He's saying you are love. Unconditional love. And that is the nature of Parabrahma, Paramatma. So here he says that where there is a relationship, there is dependence. So if there is a relationship, because he told the previous verse that out of ignorance, people give me a form and devote them, their mind and heart towards it. So here he is saying, continuing, just as the appearance and non-appearance of a dream depends on existence of one dreamer, so that one dreamer, either he is dreaming or not dreaming. Huh? One waker, either he is awake or he is not available to the waking experience. So the natural light by which once, what is the natural light? Is it this natural light? No. Is the sun the natural light? No. We are talking about the light of the self. We are talking about the light of the self. That is the natural light. So the natural light by which one sees the existence or non-existence of the universe. So where do you see existence of the universe? Where do you see existence of the universe?
Both waking and dream.
Waking and dream. Where do you see non-existence of the universe? In deep sleep. How do you know that there was non-existence of waking and dream universe? Someone must be awake there, no? Waker was not there. Dreamer was not there. Someone must be witnessing.
Alert from no backups the 338 days.
Yes, thank you. No backup required. No memory. I have to keep reminding her. She'll never learn. So, we know yesterday the waking and the waker and the waking world came, the dreamer and the dream world came, the sleeper and the absence of the two worlds was there. Who knows this? That is of the nature of devotion. That is of the nature of pure love. That is of the nature of unconditional love. That is pure devotion. So come to, and what is that? You are that. You are that in essence, not as body, not as mind, not as waker, dreamer, sleeper, not as a samadhi person, but as the essential self, you are that. Remain being that, not becoming that. Being that is true devotion. Every other devotion, you are falling short. Every other devotion, you are falling short. Then what will happen if you have devotion towards Krishna, Rama, Govinda, Shiva? Rebirth. Creation will continue. Phenomena will continue. As long as they are there. Yeah, okay, thank you. Someone is available to do my job. Before they were having an ego, they were doing their own job. Now these devotees are available. They have surrendered. Thank you. Now I can get my job done through you. What is that job? Is that the gods want to do through you? To spread love, to bring about, spread dharma, etc., etc. See? To bring harmony in the society. That is what his nature is. Every saint is only doing that. How does he do it? One is he does it by himself. Second is any devotee who comes and associates with a realized master, he gives them, okay, you do this, you do that. He may tell them, some masters tell, some masters don't tell. Our teacher told us, go and teach. So we are teaching. Another says, you see, read the biographies. They are waiting. Tapon Maharaj waited for Chinmayananda to come. And then, Avdhut Swami Nityananda from Ganeshpuri, he waited, and eventually Muktananda came. And that Muktananda then spread his name and his teachings all over the world, mainly in Australia, the Muktananda Ashram. See? So this way, just as if we also do network for what? For this only we do. if we come to know, we become pally and then we get our job done out of them. If they are available. If they are not, then we look for someone else. We do the same thing. Jahan apni dal nahi galti, wahan aage badho. Bhagavan bhi yehi kar raha hai. But what is the difference with God? He is all pervasive. He is the cause behind everything. Every being, every person who is a devotee, he is only in and through everything. He knows that. But he is waiting. Okay, who comes, who becomes available? Without his any intention, without any will, he will start expressing fully through that person who is available. Just as a mirror, if it is covered with dust, it is not able to reflect. Once the mirror is clear, the reflection, nobody is creating reflection, it is already there. Similarly, devotion is already there in everyone's heart because it is your nature. All you have to do is empty yourself. And how do you empty yourself? By coming to the one who is beyond, or the one who knows that waking, dream and deep sleep are coming and going. Who knows this? Be available to that one, to that transcendental one. This is So the natural light by which one sees the existence or non-existence of the universe is what is known as devotion. When this devotion takes the form of a strong desire in an afflicted person, I become the object of that desire. O great warrior, when this devotion takes the form of desire for knowledge, in a seeker of knowledge, I become the object of that desire of knowledge. Now he's talking about artha, jigyasu, and artharthi. So when this, so first one he says what? When this devotion takes the form of a strong desire. See, so why is that desire for the divine? That desire for the divine is only because he's identified with the afflictions, with the problems. And he wants a solution out of that, not recognizing that he is of the nature of devotion. He calls out to the divine to find a solution to his afflictions. Same is the seeker doing, the seeker of knowledge. Because the language is contradictory, because you must be seeing that in your chanting or even this understanding of the Upanishads or this particular topic at this present moment which is going on, that there is no straight answer to anything. Continuously, we are taking the opposite stance, manifest and unmanifest. We are saying that is also and this is also, and this is imaginary and that is real. And but that real alone is in and through the imaginary. Yaar, tum seedhe bolo, kya bol rahe ho? Huh? But when when the pursuit becomes so acute, and he, this seeker of jigyasu, he wants to come to the final, he wants to know. It's not enough. I want to come to know what the essence is. What is the dharma of everything? What is that source of light? What is that transcendental reality? Then he says here, the second one. Where are we? Huh? So, of that great warrior, when his devotion takes the form of desire for knowledge, in a seeker of knowledge, I become the object of that desire for knowledge. So that devotion which is emanating, that seeking which is taking place within a seeker, that devotion which is building up within a devotee, can it come from outside? Can it come from outside? Can it come from a stone statue? Can it come from a picture? Think, can it come? I'm taking you in a different direction. Can it come from a picture? Then where is it come? Where is that devotion coming from? Sussing it out from the words that we have just used before.
That's our nature.
Yeah, but where? So devotion is not coming from outside. Understand, desire is not coming from outside. Desire is also coming from within only. Nothing from outside can ever satisfy any desire. Understand? Similarly, no devotion can ever be completely fulfilled as long as you are seeking it objectively. Yes, people may make believe that we are satisfied, but now we are going further. We are seeker of knowledge. Yeah, jigyasu. He wants to know where is it starting from. But it's not. I can't see it coming from the statue or the picture or the idea from outside. It is inside me. Where inside me? Where is this desire to know coming from? Where is this devotion to knowledge? Where is this urge to know the essence? Where is it appearing? In my mind. Where is my mind? Is it outside or inside? Inside. This mind, what is it? Now, if you go systematically, what is the mind made up of? Subject and object, consciousness and matter. Matter cannot think. Matter thinks. Okay, matter. It's the subject and object which interact with each other to create a thought. But who is this? Is the thought having devotion? Is the thought having devotion in the mind? No. I am having devotion. Then who am I? Is it the father who is having devotion? Yes, father is having devotion towards the children. But where is it emanating from? You have devotion towards your children. Ammachi has devotion to all the people in the world whom she considers herself as children. So where is devotion? Is it in the person or is it in our nature? The seeker of knowledge is seeking this. And so this seeking, this pursuit, this faith with which he is pursuing this source of knowledge, this source of devotion, this source of love itself is expression of that true devotion, which is not other than the infinite self. No more words I can use. I'm trying my best to put it. See? And the last one, Artharthi, in a seeker of knowledge, O Arjuna, when this devotion takes the form of desire to achieve an end, when you want a particular result, I become that end all in all for him. So if that end is, I want Ram, that infinite reality becomes Ram. Because phenomenal, no? Ram is with form, name and form. If that seeker is having devotion and he wants Shiva, that reality, why even becomes? People have vision of the Lord, whomever they are devoted to. In Melbourne, I know, people have had a vision of Satya Sai Baba. They used to see Satya Sai Baba in their room. They never met him. Some connection from past life, some connection. When you are so devoted, when you are so surrendered, the divinity, whatever is conducive to that particular seeker, that divinity will take whatever form is helpful for that person. See? So these things, that's exactly that, when a person is seeking a particular conclusion. Conclusion is sarupya mukti, salokya mukti. Sarupya, he is seeking to become one with the form of the Lord. So there are conclusions. End we are talking about. What is the conclusion? I want the form of Ram, or I want the form of Krishna. I want to become one with Shiva. So he'll get that. But if you are not wanting any form, then that is where you will, that is what will be not, that will, that is what will be revealed. These are all revelations. This is the grace. It's directly proportional to what your intention is, and that intention fructifies if your intention with faith and love is for a particular idol, particular deity, particular form. And so is true in the physical world also. When you work with one single pointed focus towards something to the exclusion of everything, you achieve it. Isn't it? Study is also the same thing. Yes. The focus that is required for studies and what focus is required for the transcendental, the intensity is different. But the principle is the same. The principle is the same even when I am giving this lecture. This satsang that is going on, I have to be focused. I have to be alert. I have to be available. See, so the principle is the same. Question is, where do we apply? Where do we apply? So while this satsang is going on, where is your application? Where is your attention? Is your attention on the words? Is your attention on hearing? Is your attention on understanding? Or is your attention on that?
What the words are.
Because of which this whole experience is taking place. That is not outside. That is your essence. So if we are one with that, while talking, while listening, let the mind understand or fully understand or medium understand or not understand, it's okay. Our goal is not for the mind to understand. Our goal is to go beyond the mind. Our goal is to be the essence. And that being the essence, in that eternal witnessing, it's okay if mind does not understand. How does it matter? If mind understands or doesn't understand, does it affect the transcendental one? No. How does it matter if the eyes see or don't see? Does it matter to the mind? No. Think out of the box. So, this I have said it many times, that in every satsang, this is the position that you keep taking, being it. I become that, and so that conclusion, that infinite alone expresses as that particular deity or divinity that you are pursuing, for those who are wanting a particular conclusion. Continuing in 121,
एवं घेऊनि अज्ञानाते माझी भक्ति जे हे वर्ते ते दावी मज द्रष्टयाते दर्श्य करूनी दृश्य करूनी ये थे मुखची दिसे मुखे या बोला काही न चुके तरी दुजे पण हे लटिके आरिसा करी दिठी चंद्रची घे साचे परी ये तुले हे तिमिराचे जे एकची असे तयाचे दोनी दावी तैसा सर्वत्र मीची मिया घे पतसे भक्ती इया परिदृश्यत्व परिदृश्यत्व हे वाया अज्ञानवशे ते अज्ञान आता फिटले माझे दृष्टत्व मज भेटले निज बिंबी एक वटले प्रतिबिंब जैसे. He says that in this way, this devotion operates through ignorance to show me who I am, the seer, as the object to be seen. So the seer is seeking the object called the seer. Like the eyes are wanting to see themselves. So when we say, you be the eternal witness to whatever is going on, listening, hearing, understanding. So to put, in spite of all this data that is coming to you unasked from outside and inside, and yet you are finding a way within. You have to refine that art. How, in spite of everything, you stand apart and keep witnessing the whole thing. See? And that is what he says here. In this way, the devotion operates. This is the way of how devotion operates. Through ignorance to show me who I am, the seer, as the object to be seen. So if you have taken the God principle to be Shiva, then he will come as Shiva. He will reveal as Shiva. If you have taken the God principle to be Narayana, he will reveal as Narayana or Krishna or Rama or Ganapati or whatever. But if you have taken the divinity to be the self, then so be it. Then it will work. The whole thing has to collapse according in that direction. The surrender will be in that direction, the surrender of the mind. Mind is continuously getting involved and continuously getting surrendered. It is doing that, whether you like it or not. Question is where? At which altar? Altar of your wife, altar of your husband, altar of children, altar of future, altar of past, altar of bucket list, altar of desires. That desire is artha, is that altar of, you are seeking that altar. And what will be your altar if you are afflicted? Removal of afflictions is my divinity. And you hear so many people that I called to the Lord and my problems went away. I told you once when I went to Kailash, one person was there with me. He will chant Hanuman Chalisa, and whatever the problem, if he has forgotten, a 70-year-old doctor, surgeon, anything he forgets, he is old also. And lack of oxygen there. And he'll say, Swamiji, you don't worry. We first search, we can't find it. Then he says, now Hanumanji will find it for me. Shri Guru Charana Saroj. And while he's chanting, the solution will present to him. Now, what has he done? He has used the devotion for a particular end. So it's not even he is being one with Hanuman. He is using Hanuman for finding lost and found. But if he had used Hanuman, remembered Hanuman, devoted to him, it shows he has devotion. But his motivation for that devotion is worldly. Is your motivation for devotion towards the self? Hanumanji knows the self, yet he continues to be the devotee. He knows the self. He says, when I am the body, I am your servant, O Lord. When I am the soul, I am a part of you. When I am the Atma, there is no difference between you and me. So he knows, absolutely has got no cobwebs in his mind as to what his identity is. But he chooses to remain in the phenomena being the devotee of the Lord. He considers that Ram to be the first expression, the ultimate expression, the complete expression of that infinite reality. He feels that way. It's okay. And he does that without forgetting what his essence is. It's okay. See? So same way, you continue doing your jobs, you continue doing your roles, without forgetting your essence, like Hanumanji. But what this person was using Hanumanji for? For finding objects, for removing disease, for gaining wealth. That is not our purpose. When one's face is reflected in the mirror, the apparent duality constituted by the face and its reflection is due to the mirror. So when we stand in front of the mirror, it is because of the mirror we see a reflection. When there is no mirror, there is no reflection. Correct? The normal sight sees only one moon, but if one suffers from a disease known as timira, an affliction of the optic nerve, then he sees two moons. This is also very normal. You go outside, if the moon is there, you will see why go to moon? Here so many moons are sitting. You look at one face, you press your eye, you'll see two, three faces. Same person, he look like Dashanan, like a Ravana. So, all you did was just press this. Suddenly you see two, three apparitions presenting themselves there and then. Okay. The normal sight sees only one moon, but if one suffers from a disease known as Thimira, an affliction of the optic nerve, this affliction of the optic nerve can be at the physical level. We also have the same, Thimira. What is that? Timirandhasya jnananjana shalakaya chakshurunmilitam yena tasmai shri gurave namaha. Or how does it begin? Ajnana timirandhasya jnananjana shalakaya chakshurunmilitam yena tasmai shri gurave namaha. Ajnana timirana. What is ajnan? Ignorance. Timira, it makes us see the multiplicity where there is only unity. This is, so there is only one person, but I press out of ignorance, I am seeing many people, many persons within that one. I am one person, but I see myself as husband, wife, daughter, sister, mother, so many roles. I've forgotten who our attention is not on that one. When we are available to multiplicity, Timiran. Come back to the unifying principle. Be the unifying principle, not come back. Be the unifying principle. You are that. So here he says, where are we? Huh? Optic nerve. Then he sees two moons. So although I am worshipped everywhere, Lord Krishna is saying, although I am worshipped everywhere, because of ignorance, men conceive me as an object of knowledge. When the mirror is taken away, the reflection merges itself into its original. Now, if you grasp the impact of it, everything is over at this moment. As long as the mirror is there, there is a reflection. Right? Bhagwan, Krishna is saying, everyone worships me. What did he say? Although I am worshipped everywhere in different forms, in different ways, in different people have different ideas about me. Why they have different ideas about me or different forms about me? So when he's saying that, he is considering himself to be the absolute one. He says, people worship me in different forms out of ignorance. Is worship everywhere because of ignorance? Because of ignorance, men conceive me as an object of knowledge. Men, meaning human being, meaning devotee here also, or a seeker, he sees divinity as an object of knowledge to be pursued. What should that devotee be doing or a seeker be doing? If you don't pursue object of knowledge, then what do you do? Not a trick question. If you don't pursue an object of knowledge, which is some god, whom we have conceived out of our ignorance, then what do we do? Just be. When we are afraid, when we are incapable, when we have doubt, to accept that divinity is who we essentially are. When we have doubt about that, there is no doubt, but we create that doubt because this essence is without form. It cannot be engaged with objectively. This objective pursuit has to be dropped. And when you don't drop the objective pursuit, then that self, which I already am, I have to think about it, I have to be it by reading books. That's stupid. I have to read books These are the mirrors to the self that I am. Why do I need so many words? Why do I need so many scriptures? Why do I need some guidance from outside to tell me I am me? This is only because one reason. I am not ready to accept that I am all that there is. Right? Yeah, I am ignorant. But don't make that I am ignorant as a hat on your head. No, I am not ignorant. Ignorant is the mind. I can never be ignorant because I am of the nature of infinite. I can never be ignorant. You will never see negative language. So be careful how you interact with yourself. Always have positive. Yes, it is not your experience at this moment, but never, even by jokingly, undermine your potential. Your potential is infinite. You are of the nature of infinite. Why should I accept myself to be less? Just because it is not my direct experience at the moment? Why should I accept myself to be less? There are many faults. I'll keep working through them. I'll keep siphoning. I'll keep realigning myself. I'll keep falling. I'll keep getting up. But I will not accept anything less than what I am in essence. But this approach, each one of us has to, that towards that, Krishna here is giving the direction. So when he says, I am worshipped everywhere because of ignorance, men conceive me as an object of knowledge. When the mirror is taken away, what is mirror? What is your, yes, you stand in front of mirror, you see reflection. You are seeing the mirror of waking, dreaming and sleeping. Aren't you seeing every day? The waker and the waking world, dreamer and the dream world, sleeper, absence of the two, it's coming and going every day. Where are you seeing it? Who knows it? Who knows it? I know it. Where do you know it? Can absolute know it? No. Then who is knowing it? Who is witnessing it? The eternal witness, that infinite reality, in reference to the phenomena, is the eternal witness, unaffected by the phenomena. Understand? Where is he witnessing? In the mind. Then what is the mind? The mirror. What is mind? Subject-object relationship is mind. Correct? Knower, known, knowing. Seer, seen, seeing. Hearer, heard, hearing. Experiencer, experienced, experiencing. This triputi, subject, object, and instrument of knowledge, brings about a thought, and that is my flow of thought is mine. That is your reflection. Work towards removing the mind, dissolving the mind. You got nothing to do with the self. All you have to do is dissolve the mind. And what is the straightest method, direct method of dissolving the mind?
Focusing on the infinite.
Not focus, be the infinite. Be the infinite. Remain that witness of the three states. If you are remaining the witness of three states intensely or coolly, but intensely, then nothing in the three states is going to grab your imagination. Nothing in the three states will able to entangle you. Nothing in the three states will invoke a desire from you. Nothing, because what are these three states? They come, they go. I'm the undisturbed one. Who is Ishvara? The undisturbed one. Connect in this manner. So remain undisturbed. The three states are coming and going. Keep. So, are you able to focus? Do whatever. You create your own knack. There is no one knack. You create your own knack by chanting. Basically, the knack will present itself when your mind is quietened enough. That is the, at this present moment, that is the approach. If the activity of the mind reduces and you don't go to sleep, you remain alert, somewhere the click will happen. And you will, instead of identifying with waking, dream and sleep, instead of identifying with it, you will find yourself as the witness. When you remain as the witness, how long you have to remain as the witness? This is very technical I'm talking about. Some Upanishad, it will come. It's not here. Or I don't know what will come afterwards in the Upanishad. When you remain a witness of this for a considerable period of time, now this gets momentum. The momentum in waking, dream and deep sleep world goes on and on and on only when this fellow gives value to it, becomes identified with it. If it is not identified with it, it is witness, the momentum of this coming and going starts reducing. And one point will come, it doesn't have to completely reduce. It reduces even 30, 40, 50%, you will click. Spontaneously, the whole thing will just collapse. What will collapse? The matrix will collapse. The matrix of, there it is shown in the movie, the matrix of one and zero. That is, here the matrix is subject and object. One and zero. Zero is nothing. One is I. It will collapse. And what will remain? You are already there. You have never come and gone. So this, listen to what I have just narrated, this explanation, listen to it again and again and make it subjective. Don't just first become convinced that this is how it is happening. When the mirror is taken away, the reflection merges itself into its original. So when the ignorance vanishes, then the state of seeing inherent in the seeing agent merges into me, the infinite reality. So if you are seeking the infinite reality, then once the mind is gone, if you are seeking subjectively, then even the I seeking the I seeking Brahman, when we say I am Brahman, so I have accessed myself in samadhi, that I am that transcendental one, I am that witnessing consciousness, but I am the infinite one, that has not taken place. So you have to keep contemplating on that. This is another stage. But eventually that also has, that desire that I am that infinite, that also has to dissolve. And when that dissolves, when the desire itself dissolves, when you surrender in this manner, Bhagwan says, again, he takes one example. What is the time? Quickly we'll read only three more verses. पै जेवहा ही असे किडाळ तेवहा ही सोने ची अढळ परिते कीड गेलिया केवळ उरे जैसे हागा पूर्णिमे आंधी काई चंद्रू सावयवु नाही परितिये दिवशी भेटे पाही पूर्णता तया तैसा मीची ज्ञान द्वारे दिसे परी हस्तांतरे मग दृष्टत्व ते सरे मियांची मी लाभे मनवनी दृश्य पथा अतीतु माझा पार्था भक्ति योगु चवथा मणितलागा. He says, even when the gold is mixed with an alloy, it remains as pure gold. And when the alloy is burnt out, the residue remains as pure gold. And this is the purification. You are of the nature of purity. You are of the nature of absolute. You are of the nature of Purna. You have mixed with objectivity. You have mixed yourself with the phenomena. Now put yourself on fire. Tapasya karo, become focused. Then what is, then when you put yourself on fire, you become focused, what will happen? That which is the, that was mixed in you, that mixture will evaporate, but you will remain as you. See, wonderful examples he is giving here. The residue remains as pure gold. Is it not the moon endowed with all its phases before the full moon night? But it appears in all its phases on that night. In the same way, I too am seen as distinct from the seeing agent because of the mental states, because we have given validity to waking, dream, deep sleep, samadhi. Therefore, we say that the absolute is beyond the mind. Therefore, we say the absolute is the fourth state, the transcendental state beyond the three. So that beyond, there is nothing beyond. He is everywhere. He is the only thing. A wave is being told, hey, wave, oh, you have to bypass the totality of ocean to be the water. But it is already the water. There is nothing but water for. In and through the wave is nothing but water. But that language is employed because we have given validity to individuality and totality. We have given validity to the waking, dream, and deep sleep as three valid states, which are our, which make our one day of, that is one complete experience. That also we are living only one third, only waking state we are living. The other two we don't give value to. You have to give, if you are a spiritual seeker, you have to give value to the three equally. Equally means if you are giving 100% reality to waking, you must give 100% reality to dream and sleep. If you are taking dream to be an imagination, then you must give the status of imagination to waking and to sleep. If you are taking sleep as reality, that there is nothing, then you must say that dream is also nothing and waking is also nothing. But we don't do that. We are selective. Waking is real. The rest of the two, you have to give, this is another contemplation. Anyway, I am seen as distinct from the seeing agent because of the mental states. This is what the explanation was. When the state of seeing disappears, I become my true self. Yeah, become, I, it's a language. It's not becoming. It's, I, the true self is what remains. Because you are already that. It's a revelation. It's a grace. So it's nothing that a man becomes husband. That becoming is with reference to something. But the husband, can he become man? He's already man. So if he gets divorced or if his wife passes away, does he become man? It is not possible. So see the shortcoming in the translation there, in that sense. So there's no becoming the absolute one. It's gliding into your own true nature because all corruption has vanished. When the state of seeing disappears, seeing means when you are looking into the mirror, you are seeing the reflection. But now mirror is not there, reflection is not there. Then who is there? The original remains. Then where has the reflection gone? It has gone back to the original. It has gone back to the original. When the water dries up, what happens to the reflection of the moon? It has gone back to the original. same way. Where has the I gone? I has gone to the thought-free I. That is the absolute reality. So know, O Partha, that which is known as the fourth kind of devotion transcends others, which involve the dualism between the seer and the seen. So here the whole, this particular Brahma Bhuta Prasannatma na shochati na kaankshati. This verse, he is explaining, it's taking you to that transcendental devotion. Ananya bhakti. Ananya bhakti is exclusive. Exclusion of everything else. What is exclusive to everything else? The infinite reality. And what is this infinite reality? Where there is no corruption of subject and object. There is no corruption of seer and seen, knower and known, experiencer and experienced. That is the ultimate devotion. And that is your nature. Here he is saying, that is me. He has already said, I am the one who is in your heart. So we take it that way. Om Purnamada Purnamidam Purnat Purnamudachyate Purnasya Purnamadaya Purnamevavashishyate. Om Shanti Shanti Shantihi. Harihi Om Shri Gurubhyo Namaha. Harihi Om.